Welcome back, everyone. Once again, we're joined by Optimus Tom to help us preview our final game, Cloud9 Challenger versus Apex Pride. Now, we just got the end of that.
Yeah. Some context.
Yeah, what just happened?
Well, the beginning of the game was actually extremely interesting, and a lot of it came off of the back of Diamond Proxies. We'll see eventually during the highlights, but Cloud9 was trying to make things happen on the map, but Apex were always about a step or so ahead of them. This is more towards the mid-game, where some of the early-game antics of Diamond Prox had already gotten Apex Pride out to a pretty large lead, but they were just catching Cloud9 out of position in rotations over and over again, and Cloud9 were just kind of funneling into these fights where they thought they might be able to get away, but Apex Pride just punished them heavily for it, including, you know, Jhin coming in with the Deathfire touching the explosions, making a lot of these climactic end-game fights. Yeah. But Cloud9 were able to kind of pull out a little bit of the Cloud9 magic and grab themselves back into the game. Apex were unable to crack the base for about 30 minutes, including a failed attempt on the bottom lane inhibitor just before this Baron fight. They thought they were safe, but the Rumble ultimate pushes them into the back of the pit, and even though they're able to secure the Baron, Bartold is wasted on one person, the Rumble, who's already used his ultimate, and Apex Pride crumble under the pressure coming out from Cloud9 collapsing onto that Baron fight. This is where Cloud9 looked to be kind of taking back some of the control from the game, but the early game pressure from Diamond Prox especially, he was 3-0-0 at one point, wound up ending 6-2-7. It just was too much of a lead for even high shot calling to overcome.
Some very impressive stuff out of Apex, and you've really got to wonder. Cloud9, we were expecting them to be the best team in the Challenger League, and so far they've come out to a strong start, only dropping a single game to Team Liquid Academy. Well, now they've dropped their second game in 7 so far to Apex Pride.
Yeah, and the biggest surprise to me was just how coordinated Apex Pride was able to look compared to their first 2 weeks of the Challenger series. Against Enix last week, we saw some shines of like, okay, they're working more as a cohesive unit. They're looking like they play the map a little bit better. How are they going to do against some of the other teams? They were out-rotating Cloud9 Challenger, who at the top of the Challenger standings is probably one of the best teams at doing it right now.
Yeah, yeah. And with 3/5 of the returning Cloud9 roster, you've got to imagine they're not rotating Cloud9 Challenger. They're out-rotating old-school Cloud9.
Exactly.
And that's probably got to feel pretty good. Now, it can be a unique challenge to be the new player on a well-established team, but Hiya said the transition with contracts in the jungle has been a smooth one.
He isn't that shy on the team, I don't think. I feel like he trusts us to play well, and like we've been a team together, you know? So he just kind of have to like go in and do his own thing since we know how to play already. He doesn't have to like try and like learn how to play with a brand new team because the team knows how to play already. So we just have to teach him how to play with us, and it's been going pretty well.
The interesting thing that Hai brings up is he needs the contract just kind of needs to learn to play with them, whereas they were, in the first week he played, adapting to his aggressive Kindred play, adapting to the fact that he was invading upon a Graves jungle with an Elise. This game, Contracts gave up first blood to Diamond Proc extremely early on, and then wasn't really able to make the same kind of plays on the map that he was when he was given the advantage by his team. So now it's up to like, okay, so Contracts, when Cloud9 gives him the resources to get ahead, looks really good. But in the game where he fell behind, it wasn't necessarily the same.
Yeah, might be a little bit of a dynamic that we're seeing between the two about who they choose to play around, and that could possibly be some sort of effect into that. But Tom, thank you so much for your expert analysis. Yeah, we're going to get ready for this next one. Let's check out the starting lineups. First up, once again, it's Cloud9 Challenger. In the top, it's Balls. In the jungle, Contracts. Mid, Hai, AD Carry, Altec, and their support, Lemonation.
And on the red side, it's Apex Pride. After taking game one, top lane, Chris. Jungle, Diamond Prox. Mid lane, Shifter. AD Carry, Roar, and support, Conquan.
Yeah, and you said it yourself near the end of that match. Apex Pride, a lot of people were expecting them coming into the start of the Challenger Series to be one of those top teams, and they have had not a very good start since then.
Yeah, it was one of those things where you're like, oh, this lineup looks like these are guys who have been around the middle of a pack for a long time in LCS play, like Roar from Korea. You have a top laner, Chris, who's been through Challenger many times, and then you have Diamond Prox, right, who's been to semifinals of Worlds before. But that's back in the day. So people are like, okay, you know, they're getting to the point where they're saying like, oh, you know, these guys don't know how to play anymore. They're washed up. Like, they have a lot to prove still, right? They have a lot to prove, and they really want to get back And that's what stood out for me here is that Diamond Prox was being aggressive. He's being his old self. He's being the guy who controls the jungle. And he had kind of lost that the last few weeks, and there was a lot of pressure on them.
Yeah, there certainly has been a lot of pressure. But first, the big question was, they need to take a 1-0 if they want to compete for that playoff spot. Well, now they've got that 1-0. You've got to start wondering, could they be looking for the 2-0 against Cloud9 Challenger and possibly even clinch themselves a spot in the playoffs very early?
Yeah, the whole idea here is you make that match against Dream Team next week, put more pressure on Dream Team. Because if you 2-0 here, all you have to do is split 1-1, right?
And then you get that.
And then you're fine. But if you go 1-1, you still have to win 2-0. Because if they 1-1 each other, Dream Team is currently 5 points. Apex, 4 points. Now they're 5 because they have one win. So they're currently tied.
Yeah.
And if they tie in head-to-head, they have to play another game.
Exactly.
So it gets pretty complicated from there, but we'll go over tiebreakers later. But if you 2-0, you put all the pressure on Dream Team.
Yeah, we're already in week 4. We've only got one more week before we get into those final playoff seedings. And right now, Cloud9 Challenger, as we said, they need one win to at least tie for first place. And that's one win today or next week. So if they win a single game, they'll at least tie for first place. But as we said on the other side, Apex Pride seems like they might have taken a little while to come to life in this matchup, but it's do or die time, and so far in game one, they have done. Question is,
they have died.
will they also die in game number two? So we are now getting into picks and bans for our game number two between Cloud9 Challenger and Apex Pride. Azir, Cassiopeia, the Shurima mid lane banned away from Shifter, Trundle banned away from Chris, so huge in that previous game.
Yeah.
Double supports banned away from Lemon.
Yeah, keeping a lot of the engaged supports away from elimination. No Karma, he picked that every time. And then the Vladimir. So all they traded was the Vladimir ban went over to Apex, and the ban of the Trundle went over to Cloud9. And same first pick as last game. So the Rek'Sai comes through. Ryze still on the table. It's highly valued in other sets, but not so much this one. And I think Cloud9 Challenger, their draft last time was Nami Olaf, Swain Ezreal, last pick Rumble. I think that was a mistake because you saw the Trundle come through. So you should put the Swain top and pick a mid laner that you're comfortable with at that point. I think at that point you run a different mid and have the Swain really just kind of hold up to the Trundle, bully him out early because he's one of the guys that can hold up against the Trundle.
Yeah. We don't know if Lemon has been continuing to maintain the infamous Lemon's Notebook. Or if there was a different choice that decided to go into that, but we'll see if they can adapt with this next one. As Rek'Sai picked up 4 contracts, in answer though, Apex Pride, they're going to take Nami for Conquan and Diamond Prox, going back to that gank heavy Elise.
Yep. Elise wasn't seen last game. It was Rek'Sai versus Olaf. Yep. Rek'Sai changing hands, but Elise is a champion that Diamond Prox had really good performances on in the past, where it's all about that early aggression. It's about getting in there and being able to set your team up with those cocoons and then transition into the mid game.
In answer though, Cloud9 picked their bottom lane, Altec, picking away the Jhin from Roar, which means he now has the comfort of counterpicking into that. Might take the slightly more evasive Ezreal that he's hovering right now.
Yeah, I think that the Jhin pick is great right now because last game we had seen Roar go with the armor penetration build, which is the Yomu's into the Duskblade, and the Duskblade came up big there. We saw it actually snag a kill onto Balls in one of the replays where he had walked away, and it just does so much damage to a team that's not going to stack resistances. So when you have a solo lane Swain and solo lane Rumble, it's the perfect pick against them. So the Jhin pick worked out, honestly, tremendously well. But if Apex draft a tank, it's not as good with the armor penetration build, and then the crit build becomes a little bit better.
They still have some time, but Rumble being hovered might see Chris try to react to what Balls did in game number one, decides to lock it in. So it is going to be Rumble. Not a lot of room for tanks unless Shifter plays Cho'Gath mid. Haven't seen it in a while.
Nautilus tank mid back in like last split. So kind of odd, but they are setting themselves up for that top lane. Swain's still available. Up against the Rumble, the Trundle banned away. see what else they have in mind, because a lot of times it was like, oh, you know, you can pick a tank into it and avoid it early and then lock it down later. But I don't know if Balls is going to go with that style here.
Yeah, he's got 20 seconds to look for that pick, saving those blue sides for high, and Balls' counterpick for Apex Pride is for Shifter in the mid lane.
Ryze, Aurelia.
Yeah, Ryze still open. Bit short range, though. We'll see if he decides to go for it, but Ryze and Swain locked in. They decide to commit to it.
Yeah, this actually helps Altec even more on the Jhin, because they're not going to build any armor, really. It doesn't really go too well into their build. They're going to prioritize magic resistance because it's a double magic or double AP team with the Ryze and the Swain. So your Jhin, your armor penetration is going to go further for longer.
Mm-hmm. We'll see now how Apex decide to deal with that Shifter. He's got a very AP-heavy focused team. Rumble, Elise, Ezreal even a bit of AP. That might be a way to deal with AP-based champions. Just nuke them from orbit with that Veigar, but instead might be looking for long range.
Yeah, it's probably this or the Victor. It's Victor or Varus. Varus, if you want to have a mixture of damage, because Ezreal is a little bit on the magic damage heavy side too.
Yeah.
But the Varus would even out the team composition.
Yeah, decides to lock it in. Varus now taken for Shifter in answer to that Ryze. Long range. And Cloud9. They've got a pretty beefy team. They have to deal with a lot of damage from Apex's side, though.
Yeah, a lot of damage from both teams, honestly. And a lot of ways to sustain on the Cloud9 Challenger side. The Ryze ultimate, the ultimate from Swain, the Soraka heals. So you're going to expect an Executioner's Calling to come out rather early from Apex Pride if they're focused on that. But you also have to worry about stacking magic resistance, because Shifter's going to want a Maw. He's going to want a couple items first. He's going to be like, oh, I need Executioners. Oh, I need Maw. But Varus is actually kind of good into that too, because the Hail of Arrows always applies Grievous Wounds,
mm-hmm.
but it's only that area. So we'll see.
Yeah, we certainly will. Now head on over to Twitter and show the team some support. You know the drill. Hashtag C9CWin or hashtag APPWin. We'll tally those votes as we get into this match. And the question is, Apex Pride, they were able to win game number one. Can they take game number two and secure for themselves very nearly a spot in the playoffs? And, well, I guess I should say, put themselves in a much better position.
Yes.
Heading towards the end of the split.
Yes.
I don't know that it will absolutely secure them a spot, but it will put them in a position that is very favorable.
Very much so for themselves.
Welcome to Summer's Rift.
As we approach these last two sets, with next week being the final one, that every little movement matters in your games. If you throw the game has a large comeback in it. We saw that a Baron almost turned it around, but also the early game from Diamond Prox just set the team up. That you really have to feel that pressure.
Yeah. And we've seen from Cloud9 before that sometimes they do make pretty heinous mistakes in their game against Enix. They were down, I believe it was 6,000 gold?
Yeah, they weren't looking as clean the previous weeks. So Cloud9 Challenger, they started off strong. They had that 1-1 against TLA that people were really confused about. Like, hey, maybe you should have been able to close it out, but it's like there's Dardock with TLA. With Fabi as well, so it was like the old squad a little bit. And then they swapped it over, and yeah. Let's see, Conquan spotted out a little bit here. A lot of damage there onto Conquan early, and he can't back for that, so he's going to have to use a little bit of his mana to heal up. Did take the Ebb and Flow early.
Should be able to get some of that health back, but it is double sustain, duo lane, the two of them now on that bottom side of the map. So standard lanes in the mid lane, and top, however, means we will get one versus ones. And yeah, there's that Ebb and Flow. Double value for Conquan as he's able to get the full proc on it. Very difficult to do, but very rewarding. And yeah, looks like we're seeing a lot of rats traded back and forth. Healed back up by those supports, so only thing really taking a big hit during the course of this are the mana pools of those supports.
Yeah, and that's really your resource that you always have to watch out for. The Nami can basically heal forever until you are able to get rid of all of your mana. And then you're completely fine. If you have it. But if you don't, though... Sorry, other stuff's going on.
Yeah.
Yeah. Basically, Nami can keep turning mana into health over and over again, and it's not a problem.
Yeah, same thing from Soraka.
Yeah. Simple. Except she turns both into health for somebody else.
Yeah.
And then she has to land her Qs, yeah.
A little bit more sustain on that Soraka. Contracts, though, will continue to farm up through his jungle. Level 3. Hasn't taken his blue buff. Might look to gift that over to Hai after his first recall. If Hai can just hold out for another wave or two.
Yeah. Ryze, very mana-dependent early on. Ooh, missing a lot of last hits here because those minions are messing him up. And he's kind of low already on mana, and he's saving it. Because if he ooms himself, he loses all threat. And it's interesting that he started with the Doran's Ring, because we'll see a lot of Ryzes start with Sapphire Crystal and then War Potions. But he decided to go for the Doran's Ring route. We can see that as well. Both are understandable.
Yeah, looks like he just wants to continue to play it safe. He does have a very strong scaling composition, so might be looking to take his time in this. It's Diamond Procs. Very strong performance in game number one. A lot of folks were asking where that had gone for the first few weeks of the Challenger Series. Well, seems like it might finally be back. We'll have to see if he can do it again in this second game. Or if it was just a one-off get a kill sort of scenario. So far, though, things looking relatively quiet across the rift. Blue buff, there it is, finally gifted over to Hai, so he will be able to heal himself back up.
Yeah, doesn't have teleport, so.
Not heal himself up, but yeah. Heal his mana pool up.
Perfect. Heal his spirits.
Yeah.
Keep his extra force going, his magical resource. It was replenishing. But yes, he didn't take teleport, he ended up taking cleanse. Pretty much only for the cocoon and the chain of corruption. And Contracts looking for an early gank, but Diamond Procs has the counter.
It's countered around. They turn now onto Contracts. Never move. Catches Diamond Procs. He's taking some big damage, though. Ball's trying to body block. He gets some good damage. Can he burn it down? Ball's is dropped low. Chris is burning him as much as he can. First blood to Chris, the king of Challenger. He's going to continue chasing Contracts down, though. No longer has a flash. Diamond Procs.
Oh, he'll get
the cocoon max range. That's a flash from Contracts.
Oh,
and the arrow is dodged by Shifter. Hai trying to collapse and make him pay for it, but he ghosts and gets out.
Wow, it took Hai so long to get there. He's going to flash
for it. Despite the exhaust, he is able to pick up the kill and gets good damage onto Diamond, but Chris is able to walk right back up.
Hai's almost supercharged again, though.
Down.
He's going to get the root again.
Oh, he gets the
root.
This
is why Ryze is so strong.
Two kills in the mid lane.
He almost got three. This is why you don't mess with the Ryze. He hit six in the middle of that, popped his ultimate, got the movement speed, chased down Shifter, and then he almost turned onto Diamond Procs, and he almost got supercharged again. You have to pay attention to the runes on his feet when he's in that scenario.
Precisely why we're getting rid of those pizza feet. To make it look much easier to read that. Here's that fight in the top lane again.
Yeah, also changing the mechanics behind it as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, the flash to follow, the E to pick it up, and then Contracts trying to get away. The rappel onto the Scuttle Crab takes the right route. I'm surprised that Hai didn't actually run over here sooner to try and head them off of the pass. Throws out one Q, great dodge there from Contracts, and then turns onto Shifter here. He has four runes. And you see here, hits him, gets supercharged, throws again, flash, levels to six, pops his ulti, gets some movement speed, and then almost chases down Diamond Procs, but the cocoon landed. If that didn't land, then he was dead to rights. And then Chris walks forward, and hey, by the way, he's got runes again, so he's dead.
Yeah, very strong this Ryze. New Ryze will be strong in a different way. Got to see 2 hours of his gameplay yesterday. So he looks very fun, very fun.
Yeah, and you always have to keep in mind, though, that I believe it was the playtester that was playing him, correct?
CZ and Ben, yes.
Yes. So there's always a playtester assigned to a champion, and this is something that they started about 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
It started like right before I was on that team for Rek'Sai. Is they assign one person to play that champion pretty much every playtest and then go with the designer. But we'll see in a second. I'll continue that story because Chris.
Oh, he doesn't have any flash contracts trying to kite it out. He gets some big damage, but Chris runs out of ammo and Balls runs out of mana. They cannot kill him.
Diamond Ooh. Procs.
He repels towards the enemy team. Here comes High. There goes a snare. He's going to end up dropping, but a lot of damage comes across. Ooh. Silence Zone means he can't finish it off.
Nope. Can't shift forms, can't use abilities, and gets taken out there. And Diamond Prox is being aggressive because he saw that Contrax was on the top side, but High had priority mid. He's got three kills. You don't mess with a Ryze with three kills this early on. And he's probably going to take over the game if he continues to have this type of momentum. You only see that the difference is about 200 gold, but it really matters that the kills are on this Ryze.
Yeah, 3-0, stacking that tier, already has a catalyst. He's got a red buff from that kill onto Elise, so you can see Varus hanging as far back as Varus can.
He's like, you guys messed up my lane, this is my fault. But he did mess up his lane, because he was the one who got killed first by High.
Whoops.
Just saying.
But
yes, for the playtester thing, you always have to keep in mind when the person who's playing it there has months of experience on that champion already. For example, Talia. The Talia one that was done made Talia look absolutely incredible. And the truth is, you look at her win rate and you're like, oh, she looks awful. She's like 39% or something. She is 39% your first few games because she is hard.
Yeah.
She has one of the best experience win rates in the game. She has like a 63% win rate if you play her like over 25 games.
That was the same thing that happened with Aurelion Sol. Aurelion Sol, when he first came out, he had an atrocious win rate. And after a week of that he'd been out, his win rate was still awful. But people who had 100 games on him had something like a 60% win rate on him.
Yeah, there's of course, small sample size because not many people have that many games on him.
Yeah.
But there's a way to use the champion in a way that he's been balanced around, right? Because Talia was balanced around the fact that the guy who playtested her for months can like wreck everybody in a game. Right? Instead of it being like instant power where, hey, by the way, you pick up Talia, you're going to wreck everybody in the game. Like, well, you got to put some time in on her first.
Yeah.
Got to learn those WE combos.
Ooh, Diamond Prox is invading.
Nope. Again.
Cloud9, well aware. There goes the Equalizer. Balls drops the never move, but Repel gets Diamond Prox out High. Can't commit with Varus holding his position. There's a cleanse. He's able to dodge a little bit of the damage as he runs to safety.
Dodges the slow rocket as well and uses the ultimate to speed himself out of there. And Roar caught Altec, and Lemonation was roaming mid. But here comes Contrax.
Yeah, they collapse. There's going to be the knockup before he can flash. He makes it under the turret. Can they pick up the kill?
Nope.
Not quite as they make it out to safety.
Great wave there from Conquan to interrupt the curtain call. But here's the TP. They had a ward placed way behind.
Yeah, Ball's going very deep to look for Roar. Can he get it? Yes, he can. There's a bubble. Conquan will drop as well. Altec gets a kill, and Balls gets gifted one back. 5-2, Cloud9.
Yeah, it's a bloody game right now. Gold actually even, and that turret top lane got taken out. If they can get this bottom lane turret, then it'll actually give Cloud9 Challenger a decent lead. Mid lane priority as well for High. And so far, in terms of pressure advantage, it goes over to Cloud9 Challenger. Although they don't get that bottom turret.
Yeah, Diamond Prox is invading over and over, and Apex is collapsing and trying to convert kills, so of which they've been able to pick up two. But Cloud9 showing that they are still exceptionally talented players, able to answer back with a few kills and turrets of their own, bringing themselves into the lead despite Apex's proactive plays.
And with that turret kill, some item spikes have been hit. Altec, first item, Duskblade. And you can see Cloud9 Challenger, they're ready to have some team fights already. Like they have a decent lead now because of that. They got both turrets. You'd think they'd only get one, but the fact that Shifter couldn't hold up to High with those kills and now is two levels down, pushed him off.
Apex though, react to Cloud9 doing the Ocean Drake and collapse onto the pit. Yeah. They are able to take it as Cloud9 was just recalling and Balls had no teleport.
Yep.
But here's that play once again.
Picks it up, turns onto Balls, but you had already seen Chris walk through the turret, so Balls knew this was going to happen, or he had to have known because the top laner followed him through. and top laner is more powerful. And Hai dodges the E, which is the important one. He dodged the he got hit by the Q, but as long as he dodged the Rumble Harpoon, that's worth it. And then the attempted turnaround here, the root, the flash knockup. Honestly, if that flash knockup had not come through then, and it was a second earlier, Conquan wouldn't have had the wave off, and then there would have been another shot from Altec, which may have killed Roar. It may have not allowed, or may have not required Balls to have to TP in from then on. But still, picks up a kill, and then Altec picks up the other one, which allows him to complete his item.
Things looking very good for Cloud9. 5-2. Now they're going to spot that Ocean Drake was taken, but those kills are on some very large people on their team. Hai, 3 of the kills. Balls, 1 kill and 1 assist. And, speaking of Balls, finds Diamond Prox in the river and makes him pay for throwing that volatile spiderling. Here comes Contracts as well, looking for the knockup.
Yeah, he knows there's no flash, so he...
Diamond Prox.
Quite.
Oh, forced a flash as Altec collapses. Curtain call, bullet number 1. Oh, 2, 3...
If he had landed that first one, he may have killed him because he would have had that last shot in time due to the slow. So that first one, it was blind, so.
So close. That's why you gotta take clairvoyance. Duskblade doing some damage. Contracts gets snared under the turret. Balls eats another one. The chain of corruption is spreading, and now the rest of Cloud9 can't fight. Contracts goes down. True Shot Barrage goes wide, and Conquan will finally drop to the extended damage from Cloud9.
Yep, looked like it was the Deathfire touch there, and Hai the entire time has been pushing the bottom lane. No teleporter, of course, has the cleanse and the flash. And it's going to be a TP here from Chris to answer and try to clear out the wave. Doesn't have his belt available yet, so he can't clear it instantly. And they're just waiting for Roar to walk up.
Oh man, they're going to chase forward. Beatrice gets dropped as Hai looks to turn and dive the turret for this. He's got a Rod of Ages completed, but it's not quite enough flash from Chris. Doesn't quite get the proto belt flash combo he was looking for.
Yeah, was looking for that. But also, Diamond Prox missed his E. Shifter roaming down, looking to pick off Hai.
Yeah, doesn't have the chain of corruption though, so can't quite slow him. And he does have a tier one down there. Contracts is on his way to escort Hai to safety.
Escort him to
safety. Around into a team fight instead. Collapsing, well, I should say skirmish, as they collapse onto Diamond Prox. Chris is able to walk away for now.
That's my favorite safety, my favorite comfort, is escort me back into their team for some kills.
The only way you'll ever be safe is if the enemy are dead.
That's when you know.
That's, yeah.
It cannot rest until all of your enemies are gone.
I cannot rest until he is dead. What is this? An 80s horror film? Attack of the Killer Tomatoes?
Oh my god. Back in the day, man.
Oh boy. Nope, instead it's Attack of the Killer Cloud 9. 7-3, 2,000 gold ahead.
Yeah, angry about that last game. Apex took off early, and they decided that that's how they're going to play. Played around Diamond Prox invading the jungle. He got a good early kill off top, but then Hai was able to turn it around and really make the best of that bad situation.
Yeah. Cloud 9 showing that they're still very experienced players.
Yeah, especially when they're able to take the bottom tier one and mid tier one off of a single play.
Yeah.
Because they had used the pressure that they had mid.
However, Rift Herald now being picked up by Cloud9. Apex, they've got a few people on that side of the map, but they just can't quite respond. It is going to be picked up by Balls.
Kill the spiders.
Yeah, not quite. I cannot wait until we start seeing that new realm warp in pro play.
The teleport.
Rise's new ultimate. Uh-oh.
Will it reach?
Oh!
It does, but it doesn't matter because he got the last shot off anyway.
It was more a show of force, I think. Look at this. I can hit you with 4 bullets. I can hold my bike with no handlebars.
Ooh. The flash knockup after the root.
Chris tries to turn it around.
Deathblade?
Oh, that's a lot of damage. Altec picks up the kill, but Contracts eats a chain and is going to walk away. The arrow on the lemon misses. Pi is on the prowl.
Does he have flash?
Oh, gosh, he's trying. Can't quite get in range. He just gives it the rise drive-by.
Surprise!
Rolls down the window. Hey, get out of my neighborhood. He's going to steal away the blue buff for Apex now, too. Yeah, Hai is huge this game. 4-0. Already completed his Rod of Ages. Just a few gold away from finishing off that Archangel staff and turning it into a Staff of the Seraphim. 18 minutes online this rise. 18 minutes in, this rise is online.
Staff of the Seraphim. Nice.
Yes. It has two names. Similar to Manamune and Muramana.
It's a... Seraph's Embrace?
The sword? The Archangel Staff when it transforms?
Yeah.
Is it? I just thought it was Staff of the Seraphim.
No, Staff of the Seraphim is too complicated for us. We used to have like a Staff of the Magi.
Oh, yeah.
Back in the day. Damn, the Manamune Murumana thing, man. You ever hear that story?
No, I haven't.
It's a master and apprentice. What were you going to say?
No. Let's go on an adventure. Tell me of the Manamune and Murumana.
So there's different tellings of it, but... one is a master and one is an apprentice. And the apprentice eventually, and they're both sword makers. And the apprentice eventually thinks that he's overtaken the master and challenges him. And so they make the best swords they possibly can. And talk about that in a second. Okay, cool. So tier two's going to go
down. They're taking down.
They're trading on the opposite side, though.
Balls is defending.
Okay.
Should be able to keep it fine.
Yeah, it's a kind of a base race, though. So. Cloud9 Challenger, this is actually a pretty big moment in the game, so I'll get back to it in a second.
Yeah. Storytime with Zyrene, we'll be back.
Episode 2,
yeah.
Later on.
Da-na-da-da-da-na-da.
That is my theme song, I don't know. They're taking towers, and it kind of sucks for Apex.
Okay.
Let's go.
Yeah, they're going to look for the inhibitor. Minions are cleared out, but the inhibitor turret actually drops before Apex can get there to defend. Altec is in the mid lane. Cloud9 showing the superior rotations. True Shot Barrage and an arrow.
Oh,
used to clear.
Caught in rotation.
Onto contracts.
But are they caught?
Yeah, here comes Hai. All part of the plan. Eats a lot of damage. Forced to turn it around. Maybe that's not part of the plan.
Or was it?
This is a very complicated plan. Contract.
Three complex, five me.
Yeah.
He's buying time so that... they can get the turret top.
Ooh,
this
cocoon lands.
This plan's getting worse all the time.
Yeah.
And this light might be Baron as well. Like, Apex are going to continue to push mid. They killed the jungler. They decide not to go for that because they'd lose inhibitor on bottom side, but I think they're going to lose. Yeah, they're just going to get pressure here. They're going to take that top turret. Balls is at least.
Mid tier one. Drops Apex Pride, shove the minions in and back away as five. They're able to get out. Now Infernal Drake spawning soon. Trademark.
Yep.
But here that is once again.
Walks away. Hai walks up, tries to get in there. No flash for Contracts is up, but you know he would have flashed that four man. And Conquan saves the wave, uses it onto Altec again. Really well placed. And then he takes the tunnel back in, knocks up four. Team!
Assist ping! Assist ping?
Question mark. Why'd he go back in? May have misclicked it. I don't know, but it looked like it was intentional. Altec doesn't really have any options there. And he gets shut down, and they get to push out that mid turret, and they only lose their top tier one for it, so even trade. But I'm very surprised they didn't go after the Baron because there were 20 seconds on contracts.
Whoa, did he just one-shot that ward?
No, a new one got placed down.
Oh, okay.
He placed down a new pink.
So. That's a bam!
He knocked that ward into next challenger.
Damn,
week.
Soraka!
Yeah.
That's something I actually really enjoy doing. Altec going to be locked down, picked up by Shifter and Chris as they continue to pressure forward.
Yeah, really well played there. The flash chain of corruption, and then the ultimate from Chris just layering it down. Basically, they cooked him.
Yep. Like a quail in a trap.
Oh, boy, this got graphic.
But if you have a pink ward on the map and you recall and you see on the map that someone is clearing your pink ward, buy one in the shop and drop it right away.
Don't do that. It's a waste of gold.
And then undo.
Huh?
I don't know if the undo works.
No, you're making it up now. You're giving me advice you don't even know.
That's totally worth for the psychological warfare.
Oh my
the
God.
Undo makes you feel better if
you
it works.
You can't click it.
But it probably doesn't.
Oh my God. Yeah, you psych yourself out.
It's about sending a message, Irene. You want to deny that 30 gold to the support. Or whoever else happens upon your ward. More often than not, for me, it's the enemy mid laner.
That's not so much.
And then in chat, you'd send a really aggressive frowny face.
Yeah.
So you sure showed him that you don't know how much one-to-one conversion of gold is. You're like, hey, I spent 75 to stop you from getting this much. And hey.
Lemonation gets picked off.
But
they are able to answer back with a kill on the Shifter. That's Chris split off from the rest of his team, high on the back line, keeping Diamond and Chris busy. Now Balls will flash forward aggressively to try to keep chase. Misses the never move. High collapses once again. They're able to get the kill onto Diamond Proxus. Chris is going to run. Ooh, shields himself.
Oh, he needed that shield also, or else he would have died there to the Swain.
Oh, contracts.
High comes back up thanks to the Guardian Angel that he has.
Misses.
And they're going to be able to rotate here and get this inhibitor.
That is a very early Guardian Angel and a very early Guardian Angel pop. But they do finally take the inhibitor 24 minutes in. Cloud9 Challenger looking a lot more convincing. Church Hop Barrage is going to miss. Are they continuing to chase? Equalizer's halfway off of cooldown. Konkwan is giving them speed.
Yeah.
Doesn't have Tidal Wave either.
They don't really have mana either.
Ooh, High eats a lot, but there's a huge heal from that Soraka. They're trying to turn it around, but Altec just does so much. Chain of Corruption.
Here comes Lemonation.
Balls. Lemonation able to get a clutch heal off, but not enough to save Balls.
Yeah, didn't end up going for Balls. Went for Altec there because Balls died right before, and he decides not to go the same way.
Oh.
Shifter the Q and High.
Oh, he misses. Shifter goes wide. That's a quick two kills for a High. Double kill. Once again, charging the rune, and Apex might have overstepped their bounds. Oh, God, contracts! He's doing his best Meteos impression as he races past and will die.
Wonder where he learned that one.
Yeah. Oh, man.
This is craziness. Infernal Drake's up, Diamond Prox. Hi, he's fed.
What?
He's got a Soraka.
Oh.
Tries to give him the alley-oop.
Give him the old 1-2.
Roar.
Oh, High is godlike. 7-0-2. Oh, he's trying to chase it. He's trying to chase it. There's the equalizer, but not able to collapse.
How many times has Chris been in these fights? What is going on?
I think this is his third time. Oh my God, does he have enough? Oh my gosh. Oh no. 8-0-2. Lemonation with sub 100 health, 15-9. Cloud9 Challenger, I can't even begin to get a tally on that fight.
Oh my God.
Can you even call that one fight? That was like an entire war.
That was insane. How many times did Chris die? I think Chris died two, three times.
He died three times.
I think he died three times,
yeah. He respawned twice over the course of that.
Damn. That's insane. Well, I wonder which fight this is. This is the first part of it.
Oh, yeah. We're going to be here a while.
Yeah, we are. High, kiting backwards. They're just waiting. Balls has blue buff. So then he tries to turn it around. The root comes out, and then he's facing the wrong way because Chris tried to turn around in that instant. Gets picked up by the Dusk Blade. Again, the Rumble's dying to that. Lemonation walks up, not able to get the heal off onto Balls, and then has to walk around. Shifter lands the first Q. He's walking around. I don't even know if the second Q would have killed him because that first one didn't really do too much either. And then he walks forward, gets the shield, dodges anyway, and then it's the turnaround, the double kill. And then they continue to run them down, and hey!
Meow.
Got him! takes the tunnel that was there.
They'll never see it coming.
They'll see him run right past them, and that's the beauty of it. They always see it coming.
Yeah. They'll never see it because they see it.
They'll pretend like they never see it, never saw it, but still, this is just going to be all-out brawls here.
Yeah, this is fist fight after fist fight between the two, but Cloud9 Challenger continuing to take the advantage fight after fight. Two Drakes to one, six turrets to two. That inhibitor still down.
Oh, dueling the Baron, Ryze and Rek'Sai. It is going to take a lot of the mana from him, but he has blue buff, so he's 100% fine to do this. It goes down very slowly in this case, but there's that ward in the back that they can't see because their pink ward doesn't reach far enough.
Ooh, so they do have vision of this. Apex correctly shove forward and force the disengage from Cloud9 Challenger.
And now I can tell the Monomune story. So, master and apprentice, sword makers.
Yep.
The apprentice thinks that he can, he's overtaken the master, and so they're both making the best swords they possibly can of their entire craft as a challenge to the other. The young one, the apprentice, presents his sword, and what they do is they go to the river. They put their sword, he puts his sword in the river with the point down, and it cuts everything. It cuts the river, it cuts the wind, it cuts the fish going by, it cuts everything. It's incredibly razor sharp, and he's proud. He thinks it's fantastic. It's like, it's so sharp, it is just obliterating everything in its path. Mm-hmm. And then the master puts his sword in, and nothing's getting cut. Everything is kind of peaceful around it. The fish are still like floating around it. Nothing is harmed by it. And the apprentice thinks he's won. A monk walking by sees all of this, runs up to the master and goes, "Your sword is absolutely incredible." And the apprentice is baffled and asks why. And he says, "Because your sword that you made cuts everything, good, evil. It is indiscriminate of what it attacks, whereas the master's only goes for the things it needs to." And Cloud9 are trying to close this game out and try to get into playoffs, and that's what they need.
Yeah, they're going to chase forward onto Roar, who finally goes down. That was an excellent segue, Zyrian, into this fight as they get one kill. Don't know that they have enough quite to end the game just yet, as that is only Roar. And Cocoon will find high. He's actually CC'd. Contracts gets brought low before he's forced to hop away. Altec cannot save High, who might have overextended just a touch.
Yeah, even blew his GA there, and that's going to be still just a 5k gold difference between these two teams. Neck and neck, honestly, for all intents and purposes, these team fights can go either way. If High doesn't have his GA now, it's much easier for them. Dianfrox walks up and he's like, I knew it all along. Flashes afterwards and belts away. And then that last one hits Conquan, chunks him for 600, and then Contracts flashes, only catches Roar on the backside of it, but that's enough to take him out. And then they continue walking forward. The disengage is no longer in effect for Apex because they start tunneling back in. Chris goes to the bot side. They think they're completely safe here. But there was a pink ward. They catch High. They shut him down. Contracts burning, and then throws an arrow back. Doesn't quite hit him.
Yeah.
But yes.
That was High's first death in this game. 8-1-3. Right now, Lemonation has also only died once, so he's 0-1-10. Seeing huge performances out of Cloud9 Challenger this game. But not quite able to close out the game, as Apex Pride are effectively taking advantage of Cloud9's mistakes whenever they get the opportunity to, though they are making some mistakes themselves, such as overextending to chase Cloud9 Challenger. Now 31 minutes in, as you said, 5,000 gold between the two. Next Drake is going to be an Ocean Drake, which Apex Pride would quite enjoy, especially considering how they already have one. And Baron is the name of the game. Vision currently favoring Cloud9, but High is split pushing. Or flanking?
Flanking? I think he's flanking.
He's flank pushing.
He doesn't have flash, so
Roar! Forces Roar to flash over the wall.
Yep. Makes him take the long way. Roar, yep, has to blow that summoner spell.
Yeah, suddenly Whitebeard. No good.
Where was he days ago?
Look to the east on the morning of the third day.
That actually was the east of the map.
That was. So.
It's perfect.
On the morning of the third day, I shall...
The 30th minute. Illuminati. Everything's lining up, but still. Ocean Drake, up soon. Not a priority Drake for either of these teams at the moment. You would get it if you are banking on the Elder Drake, because that would be the next one to spawn afterwards. But Baron is really what Cloud9 are looking for, and still getting wards into that backside of the pit. See if Contracts even finds that one.
Apex Pride clearing out wards in the mid lane. Shifter. giving us the old Ryuga Waga Teki wa Kurau.
Oh my god, don't do this.
As he fires down the mid lane.
You're fired.
Arrow after fired. Arrow.
Yeah.
Whoa, there's an arrow onto Altec. He gets shrunk down to below half.
Vahai is still trying to flank. He's just walked over like three wards.
Oh my god, they know he's there.
Saving Private Hai at this point.
Oh,
like
no.
They're going to try to chase him down, but he's got Cloudrake, the Covenant Cloudrake. It's done it again.
The master plan.
You think you're stalking him? He is faster than you, son.
He is stalking you. At this point, I think he actually is. Now shoving towards the top side, going to shove some minions into the tier two. That's going to force Chris to pull and react to that. Meanwhile, big minion wave on the bottom means that Drake is undefended.
Yep. Ocean Drake time for Cloud9 Challenger. It would be their third. And then they're able to push out the bottom side if they want to. In all honesty, like they're just looking for the fight. They're trying to end the game off of a fight. It's still just that 5k gold advantage. They haven't gotten anything since. There's an open inhibitor bottom. Not even split pushing with the Swain, nothing like that. I don't even know if his Rift Herald buff is still around, but oh, Lemon is caught!
Oh, there's an equalizer on his face. He gets destroyed. Contrax is forced to hop away. And Apex pick up a quick kill onto the support. The sustain is now gone for Cloud9. Vahai! Oh, he drops the Desperate Power.
They don't have a way to interrupt this. Conquan had used it before.
Ooh, Diamond Proxy. It's a big bullet.
Yep. Diamond Prox looking for the... Ooh, that, tried to cocoon it.
Good
damage. Wow!
That damage was enormous. Hai chases forward and gets the kill on the Roar. Flash knockup finds three. Hai is going to look for yet another one, but Altec picks up a double kill. Chris, silenced by his own passive, will drop and give a double kill to Hai as Balls chases on to Conquan. Yep. Eventually, he'll be able to catch up with this fish in a jungle.
Like shooting fish in a jungle.
There he goes, ace for Cloud9 Challenger.
And now they're going to push down this bottom lane. 17 seconds onto Diamond Prox. They're going to be able to pick up this little inhibitor and then crack the base on the middle side and maybe get that inhibitor as well. The minions are a little far off, so I don't know if they'll be able to end the game quite yet, but they're still going to get a lot off of this and set themselves up for a good Baron.
Yeah, definitely open up the map a little bit more. They haven't been doing such a great job in the past 10 minutes of expanding on their advantage, but finally they find a fight and are able to turn it around despite Apex finding the pick on the elimination. So Cloud9 still showing they've got what it takes to play at high levels, and Hai is in the exact same bush as last time, but this time he brings a pink ward of his own and is able to clear it out and get the kill safely.
And they cleared out all the vision in the pit. Except for that, there they go. And now Hai is still standing here, going for more.
Oh, so greedy for these kills.
I mean, he's not greedy. He's actually just trying to zone them off. It's the right play to do.
Yeah.
Look at that. Altec's critting that thing for 1,000 when he gets his fourth shot.
Oh, that's a lot of damage.
Yeah, that is more than a jungler can smite for. So that's insane. Like that build.
77.
Exactly. That build on Jhin is disgusting for that reason. Because his last shot just does so much damage on its own, but then you make it so that it does even more. It's like your crit is extra critting. It's crazy when you have that Infinity Edge on top of the armor penetration.
But right double there. Crit.
That wasn't even a fourth shot crit. That was an 826 just flat crit from Altec.
Oh, with the exhaust,
yeah,
he does 731 damage.
This build is disgusting. I'm actually very surprised when people don't go this build against a team that has three squishies. So if they have, or sorry, four squishies, if they have a tank, then it's okay to go between the builds. If they have two tanks, then you definitely go like the crit build, mostly because this one becomes semi-reliant before you get your Infinity Edge on your curtain call damage, and a tank can just stand in front and take all that damage.
Yeah. Ooh, Balls face checks into the jungle.
He's going to be able to survive a lot of this, though.
Oh, Zonya's, he's healing it back up. He's got Lemonation behind him. Just the health and mana battery brings him back up close to full as Hai chases forward for yet another kill. Altec gets one. That's going to be a lot of members of Apex dropping low. 5 versus 3. They could be looking to end the game.
Yeah, there were those minion waves right now. The bottom wave, kind of big, but it's way down there. This middle wave is now just pushing up. They have the Baron buff. Cloud9 Challenger are going to try to push this through and secure a spot in the playoffs.
Here go the minions. Arrows finding all tech. Shifter, pretty good aim so far, but he needs to be able to get some kills. The turret is dropped. Number two is taking enormous damage. Altec doesn't even care anymore. While high zones from the far side, the two Nexus turrets go down. Cloud9 are at such low health. Chain of Corruption finds contracts. True Shot Barrage misses. Are they going to be able to turn it around? Will Apex Pride be able to answer back? No, Cloud9 are onto the Nexus, and it drops. Cloud9, Challenger, take the game and tie it up 1-1 with Apex Pride.
And they also secure a playoff spot after that. So Cloud9, Challenger, 100% in. They have a playoff spot, not necessarily number one, pending the results from next week that we'll be having. So week five is going to mean a lot here for the placements and jockeying for position. But there is one last bit of playoff work that Dream Team and Apex need to put in because they play each other next week. Enix has now secured a playoff spot. They confirmed it backstage. It did take a while, but they did say that. Nova.
Okay.
Enix is out. Nova secured a spot. That's what I meant. Sorry. But yes. So we know so far, Nova, Cloud9 Challenger, 100% in the playoffs. Enix out.
Mm-hmm. So pressure is on for Team Liquid Academy, who I believe are also in, and Dream Team and Apex.
So Team Liquid Academy has 6 points. Apex and Dream Team both have 5.
Mm-hmm.
And they play each other. So if they split that 1-1, there's a 3-way tie if TLA gets 2-0'd.
Mm.
If TLA wins any of their games, then they're guaranteed in.
So we've got to ask, who's Team Liquid Academy playing?
They are playing...
In this upcoming
They're playing
schedule.
Enix. So.
Enix. The pressure is on for these teams. So Team Liquid Academy, they obviously have a very strong strength of schedule coming into this next match, looking for that final playoff spot, where you've got to look at a team like Dream Team. They're probably kicking themselves once again because it's getting down to the wire.
Yeah.
Second split in a row.
And it's interesting because we talked to Acadian and we're like, who's missing playoffs? And he's like, Nova. Well, Nova just played Enix 2-0, 7 points. Their record right now for Nova is 2-1-1. Like, they've only been 2-0'd one time. And frankly, like, Nova does look like they're a squad that fairly new is still performing well.
Mm-hmm.
Dream Team. Acadian's team, they're going to have to step up against Apex, who they said, you know, scrim results have been showing that Apex is looking up and up. But one of those two teams, Apex or Dream Team, missing playoffs, but possibly TLA as well.
Yeah, I think scrim results aside, from what we saw in this series, Apex is definitely looking up. They took a game off of Cloud9 Challenger. The only other team to do that has been Team Liquid Academy.
Yep.
And they looked competitive for most of game number two. So the pressure is definitely on. We talked about it at the beginning of the split. This is looking like the most competitive Challenger Series split we've had in a very long time. And this next week is going to determine a lot.
Yeah, it's the one with the most parity between the teams, save for kind of Enix at the bottom having not won a single game. But it's like Cloud9 Challenger, former LCS players. Nova have some imports, have some great new talent. TLA, a lot of former LCS players like Piglet, right? And then Moon. And then they have guys who played on like Ember and Dream Team. They've been around. They have guys coming back in. They're looking good. And then Apex just has a plethora of talent on that lineup.
Yeah.
So through and through, like when we talk about the Challenger Series, it's really like LCS second chance here.
Yeah.
For
definitely a lot of improvement that we're seeing from these players. But with only 1 week left of regular season matches, here's how the teams are lined up. Cloud9 Challenger add another point to their tally, which is good enough to lock in a playoff berth. Also securing their spot in the postseason is Nova.
Yeah, and still on the hunt for those last two spots are the Team Liquid Academy in third and Apex and Dream Team, who are sharing fourth. Meanwhile, Enix, they are locked into that last place spot.
That's going to do it for us tonight, though. But the LCS action picks back up tomorrow in Europe with Splice taking on the Unicorns of Love.
Yep, and then we will be back next Wednesday with Week 5 of the North American Challenger Series. That hits your streams with Cloud9 Challenger playing Nova and in our spotlight matchup.
Then we'll pick up game 2 of Enix versus Team Liquid Academy, and we'll conclude the night with Dream Team facing off against Apex Pride. As always, that hits your streams at 6 p.m. Pacific or 3 a.m. for all you night owls staying up late in the Central European time zone. Now, before we sign off, Zyrene, Do you want to finish that sword story?
I think I did.
Yeah?
I think I did. Basically, Monk comes by and says, you know, maybe your sword is better. Kid says, why? Tells him yours is evil because it cuts everything. Yours is good because it cares about what it cuts. Mm-hmm. And so it chooses. So it doesn't do it indiscriminately. And then there's very different endings to it. Sometimes there's like a story where the boy gets killed.
Yeah,
it gets kind of dark at that point.
They practice the swords on each other.
But there's ones where like the kid repents and he's like, I need to like change my ways. There's ones where he's stubborn and he's like, I'm still going to do this because it's better. And there's one where he just gets flat out killed. So I choose the one where
the current version, where one transforms into the other when you have 750 out of 750 stacks.
Boom. When he cries enough.
Exactly. We've gone full circle. Now, on behalf of myself, Zyrene, Tom, and all of the hardworking men and women toiling away in the Challenger Labs, thank you for joining us, and good night. So which sword would you rather have?
The one that cuts.
Yeah?
Yeah. No. Took Hai so long to get there, he's gonna fight for it.
Despite the exhaust, he is able to pick up the kill and gets good damage onto Diamond, but Chris is able to walk right back up.
Hai's almost supercharged again, though.
Down.
He's gonna get the root again.
Oh, he gets the
this
root.
This is why Ryze is so strong. But here's the TP. They had a ward placed way behind.
Yeah, Ball's going very deep to look for Roar. Can he get it? Yes, he can. There's a bubble. Conquan will drop as well.
Oh. Shifter to Q and Hai.
Oh, he misses. Shifter goes wide. That's a quick two kills for a Hai.
Dynaprox looking for the... Oh, that tried to cocoon it.
Good damage. Oh! That damage was enormous. Hai chases forward and gets the kill on the ward. Flash knockup finds three. Hai is going to look for yet another one.
Yo, man, look at me, man.